In this video, we're going to look at the topic of crystals as they're used in the New Age movement, and we're going to look at two primary ways we can understand the use of crystals in light of scripture. In the New Age movement, crystals are believed to be metaphysical healing tools that have the ability to raise your vibration, improve your mood, and cleanse the energy fields of your body. What they mean is that at an energetic level, crystals emit their own energetic signature. They have a certain tune to them, a certain resonance or frequency to them. One crystal might have the frequency of inspiration. Another might have one of courage or of love. And so when you carry these crystals around with you and use them in healing or in therapy, their energy rubs off onto you and into your energy field, transferring their energetic properties over to you. In the New Age movement, they're also believed to be healing wands where you can bring through your own intention and your own energies or the energies of spirit guides or ascended masters or aliens or archangels through the crystal as a sort of wand where it then becomes a transmitter for energy to pass through you into a subject. Healing crystals harness the life-giving elements of the earth and the universe. Harnessing the energy of the sun, the moon, and the oceans, semi-precious stones connect us to earth as soon as we come into contact with them. Each crystal has a unique vibrational energy that works to clear blockages and ward off negative energy. Here's a summation of how crystal healing is supposed to work according to the Book of Stones, and there's a lot of jargon in this one. When we bring the crystal into our electromagnetic field, two things occur. The electromagnetic frequencies carried by the stone will vibrate with related frequencies in our own energy field through the physical law of resonance, creating a third larger vibrational field. The nervous system is attuned to these shifts in energy and transmits this information to the brain. Here, the frequencies stimulate biochemical shifts that affect the physical body and shift brain function.
In the physical world, you pick up a crystal and feel it as something separate from you that you're just holding. But on higher frequencies, you're actually interacting with that stone energetically. This interaction then causes changes to your structure and psychology through your own energetic systems. It begins a process of rebalancing the energetic structure of your body, and in a sense, can help you heal. Now, consciousness is of course the determining factor of if you are going to be accepting of these new frequencies coming into your being through crystals. I'm not going to say crystals will heal you, because if you fight them and are non-receptive to these frequencies, you will continue to create the disharmony within yourself. Ultimately though, crystals can be used to retune your whole being back to a state of harmony and flow.
So the first thing we need to ask ourselves, is there any evidence that crystals actually have healing properties? Is there any evidence that suggests that this is true? And the only real study we have on this subject demonstrates to us that crystals are no more effective in producing healing than a placebo. Psychologist Dr. Christopher French and colleagues from the University of London conducted a study to determine if crystal healing was legitimate. 80 participants were asked to fill out a questionnaire to indicate how open they were to the supernatural, and then they were asked to meditate with a crystal in their hand. Some of these crystals were real, and some of them were fake. They didn't know whether the crystal in their hand was real or was fake. Before meditating, they were asked to observe any tingling or energy running through their hand while holding onto the crystal. After they finished meditating, they answered another questionnaire where they recorded any effects they felt from the crystal in their hand. Those who held real crystals experienced no greater effects than those who held fake crystals. Interestingly, those who were more open to the supernatural experienced more sensation in their hand, as did those who were primed and encouraged more by the person conducting the study. We found that lots of people claimed that they could feel odd sensations while holding the crystal, such as tingling, heat, and vibrations, if we'd told them in advance that this is what might happen. In other words, the effects reported were a result of the power of suggestion, not the power of crystals. There is no evidence that crystal healing works over and above a placebo effect. So what this demonstrates to us is that it doesn't matter what type of rock is in your hand. It could be soil, it could be an ordinary stone, it could be a piece of wood. What's going to create the sensation and the feelings of energy transference and any healing is your psychological disposition to the object you are holding. So contrary to the statements of those in the New Age movement and what the billion-dollar crystal industry would have us believe, there is no actual evidence that crystals have any healing ability. So practically speaking, they aren't useful for anything. It's not enough to say, well, the silicone in crystals can conduct electricity, therefore, they can conduct or they emit metaphysical energy that just doesn't follow. Now, biblically speaking, there are two primary ways we can understand the use of crystals in healing and in therapy. Whether or not they work in some scenarios or in some instances or not at all, to use them for healing or for any spiritual purpose is to commit a form of idolatry. An idol is anything that replaces the one true God. Idolatry is having or inventing something in which one trusts in place of or alongside of the only true God, who has revealed himself in the word. So idolatry in a narrow sense is to worship objects or beings in the place of God, but in a broad sense, idolatry is when we use or revere anything in the place of God. So when we look to something God created to provide us with supernatural healing, spiritual healing that only God can provide, we commit a form of spiritual idolatry. Let's look at a few verses where God is clearly identified as being our spiritual healer. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. O Lord, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness. And from all your idols I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh, and give you a heart of flesh. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. Additionally, there are dozens of verses about God being our emotional healer and our physical healer, but these verses in particular indicate that God is our supernatural healer, healing us from the spirit outward. This happens initially when our spirit man is resurrected from spiritual death to spiritual life in Christ through faith, through something known as regeneration. And then we're continuously being renewed and brought to life day by day through sanctification by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. So we go from being spiritually dead in trespasses and sins to sharing in the resurrection life of Jesus, and crystals, gemstones, they cannot do this for you. If you're using crystals in spiritual healing or for spiritual therapy, you are bypassing God's method of spiritual healing, and you're using the creation rather than the creator to bring about this effect in your life. And even if they do not work and don't produce any effect in reality, this is still a textbook example of idolatry. Now, this is not true of medicine, because medicine does not seek to bring about supernatural healing to the patient. The use of crystals, however, attempts to bring about supernatural metaphysical healing that only God can bring us. And when we appeal to created things for supernatural use in the place of God himself, we fall short of God's standard to revere, adore, and value nothing else above him. So even if they don't work, the first way we can understand the use of crystals is idolatry. Now, if they do work, we can also understand them as being witchcraft. Because what you're doing is you're trying to manipulate metaphysical energy apart from God for your own benefit, which falls under the category of sorcery, magic, and witchcraft, all of which are prohibited in scripture. So even if crystals could be used for magic arts in some way to bring through energies from archangels or from ascended masters, or could act as some kind of a wand to project your energy through into a patient or a subject, to do so is to transgress God's commandment that we should refrain from sorcery. The definition of magic is the use of means, such as charms or spells, believed to have supernatural power over natural forces. The art of producing a desired effect or result through the use of incantation or various other techniques that presumably assure human control of supernatural agencies or the forces of nature. Witchcraft is the religious practice involving magic and affinity with nature, usually within a pagan tradition. Witchcraft is the art or power of bringing magical or preternatural power to bear, or the act or practice of attempting to do so. And sorcery is, of course, the use of magic. The Bible says, "There shall not be found among you anyone who burns his son or his daughter as an offering. Anyone who practices divination or tells fortunes or interprets omens, or a sorcerer or a charmer or a medium or a necromancer or one who inquires of the dead. For whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord." Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. In the NIV, sorcerers here is actually translated as those who practice magic arts. So even if they do work under certain circumstances, using them is condemned in the Bible and is something that is incompatible with salvation. No practicer of magic will enter into heaven on Judgment Day. Only those saved by faith with the evidence of repentance from such forms of sorcery will see the kingdom of God. So the use of crystals for metaphysical purposes, it's idolatry and it's witchcraft. Now, I'm personally agnostic as to whether or not they serve any occultic purpose at all. Perhaps it's the case that once we yield to the principalities over witchcraft and over sorcery, crystals do act as a sort of transmitter for demons to bring their power through into the natural. Some kind of occultic tool might have been used, for example, in Exodus chapter 7 and Exodus chapter 8, where the magicians of Egypt were able to replicate Moses and Aaron's miracles. And I find it interesting that a lot of the channeled material, the material that comes through contact with interdimensional entities who we would call demons, it always seems to be pointing people back towards the usage of crystals. And that doesn't really make sense to me personally if they're absolutely vacuous and empty of all purpose. So I'm personally agnostic as to whether or not they offer some metaphysical benefit in the practice of witchcraft. But if they do, it's condemned in scripture as a sin worthy of hell. Now, can Christians use crystals for jewelry or for decor? The answer is obviously yes. They're not bad in and of themselves just because they've been abused for occultic purposes. Crystals are a part of God's creation, which he called good. However, if you've just come out of the New Age movement, it's not a good idea to surround yourself with the same occultic tools that your brain and your soul is used to associating with a certain spiritual experience, whether that be a mystical experience or a transcendental experience or even just feelings of nostalgia. It's kind of like if you're used to associating a certain song with an ex-partner of yours, then you decide to listen to that song over and over and over again. It's not going to be healthy for you psychologically or spiritually. So I would say if you have a history in the New Age movement, I would not have anything to do with crystals because I don't want to put a stumbling block before myself and interfere with the process of sanctification that God's trying to work in me. I have two videos on occult objects which address how they give demons legal ground and how holding onto these objects prevents your mind and soul from being able to renew and refresh itself from association with occult objects. So to recap, crystals are useless for healing in and of themselves, and since God alone is to be the source of our spiritual healing, crystal healing and therapy is idolatrous by nature. If it does in fact work, then it's also witchcraft. And it might be the case that crystals do serve some kind of occult purpose when used in conjunction with demonic power. Crystals are not evil in and of themselves, but wisdom and caution should be used if you are planning on using them for decor or jewelry, especially if you have a history in the New Age movement. So thanks for watching. I hope this video has given you clarity on the topic of crystals. If you would like to support more content like this, you can do so on Patreon. Links in the description. Take care, and I'll see you guys in the next video.
I believe that I was God, and that we could all become Christ too, if only we realize this inherent connection we have to God.
At 19 years old, New Age blogger Steve Bancarz was a spiritual guru to hundreds of thousands of followers. For Steve, it had spiritual and financial benefits.
I was getting 200,000 to 300,000 views on it a day, and the income to me was an affirmation from God. I believe God was rewarding me with helping wake people up into a higher state of consciousness.